that's who I am. Just let me be who I am to you. How many things would be different if we would just let God be who He is supposed to be to us? It's preaching time.
Amen.
Thank you.
For those of you all that need a Bible that one of our ministry technicians know, I would draw your attention to Ephesians chapter number 4. We're going to be in verse 7. Ephesians chapter number 4, verse 7. Once you have it, if you rest on your feet. That's how the old folks used to say. Rest on your feet. That's a nice church way to say, stand up. If you're so able just to honor the word of God in the place of God by the people who say they know God. Ephesians chapter number 4. Ephesians is in the New Testament. It's a small book. It only has 6 chapters in it, so it's really easy to miss. It's a book, but technically it's a letter. It is an epistle that Paul wrote to a city called Ephesus. It is to encourage, inspire, and to instruct the church that he planted some time before the writing in an effort to help keep them on one accord to continue in the faith. And whenever we come to church, we come in an effort to be instructed, encouraged, admonished in the faith. Because I don't know about you, it can be rough keeping the faith. I ain't gonna get no help. Maybe when you got saved, you stayed saved without any problem. But every now and again, it's good to have a word that was written before you were come back and encourage you where you are in order to take you where he wants you to be. That's how you know it's God, by the way. Mm-hmm. When you're able to receive a word in your now that came before you were, so that you can be who you are. Amen. There's no other book like the Bible.
Amen.
Nothing else can do what the word can do, and that is the reason why we stand, because we're in anticipation of the strength we need to stand for tomorrow. You wait for me to preach, I'm already there. Ephesians chapter number 4, starting at verse 7. It is our custom to read our confession, which is on the screens. I may drop out, but you continue on, and then I'll read the text in your hearing. Let's do this. This is my Bible,
the word of God. Today, the word of God will transform me. I am who it says I am. I have what it says I have. I can do what it says I can do. I will never be the same. In Jesus' name, amen.
Ephesians chapter number 4, starting at verse number 7, reads this way. But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Reach across the aisles and grab your neighbor by the hand as we prepare ourselves to go to God in prayer. I would that you would consider the theme, the little tag that I'll put on this text in an effort to keep our thoughts in unison. The chosen. The chosen. Eternal God, our Father, it's in the precious, holy, and matchless name of He who is our Christ that we come again to say good morning. Thank you for the privilege, the honor, and the joy that is ours for gathering in this place around your word according to your purpose. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh in this place. Heal, deliver, set a captive free. Do what only you can do. Allow your word to come alive in our midst and become part of our living when we leave. We thank you in advance for what it is that you are about to do. Neighbor, I squeeze your hand just as a sign, just as a point of contact, to let you know that God is this close to you.
Amen.
And whatever it is you stand in the need of, whatever it is that is about to break out in your life, He sent me to be next to you as a sign, as a point of contact, as agreement. Because one can send a flight 1,000, two, 10,000, and the agreement to that thing that's on your heart. The agreement for that thing that's in your mind. The agreement of the promise that's over your life. I'm here in an effort to help you give birth to it. I'm here in an effort to help you get over it. I'm here in an effort to help you be who it is that God called and created you to be. For this is our prayer in Jesus' name, and all of God's children said,
Amen.
Amen. You may have your seat in the presence of our God. But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift, the chosen. In Matthew's Gospel, the 22nd chapter, there is a phrase that I'm pretty confident we have all either heard, and if you've heard it, you've probably used it. Round about the 14th verse of the 22nd chapter of Matthew's Gospel is a line that says, many are called, but few are chosen. This church popular statement has been used to distinguish between those who 2 Timothy chapter number 3, verse number 5 says, have the appearance of godliness, but deny its power. We use Matthew 22:14 in an effort to distinguish between those individuals who look like and sound like God, but ain't got no power to prove they know God. In 2 Timothy 3, we are admonished to stay away, Bruce, from anybody who's faking it. The prevailing thought within certain pockets of the church is it's our business to protect God. And whenever it becomes the thought process of anyone in God's house that they have the responsibility to protect God, those individuals become the very ones who are selective about what portion of God they share. With this mode of operandi, this modus operandi, we choose who goes to heaven and who don't. Individuals, by the way, who sit in this pious seat of authority dictate who's going to go to heaven and who is destined to go to hell based on their interpretation of who God can use and what God chooses to use in order to make us who God has chosen us to be.
Come on, sir.
So, in an effort to do my job today, I really want to look at Matthew chapter number 2 in an effort to give some gravitas to Ephesians chapter number 4. Are you all right?
Yes.
Let me read to you this parable in Matthew 22 where this statement is made. For those that may not know, a parable is an earthly story that gives both context and content about heaven.
Right.
Jesus uses this story so that we might get our minds right about what our business should be if heaven is where we desire to go. The parable where we find Jesus using this statement to make his point should not result in us concluding that we have been left with the power, let alone the ability, to tell who God can use, but instead it reveals how God selects the chosen. Matthew 22, verse number 1 says this, again, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son and sent his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding feast. But they would not come. Again, he sent other servants, saying, tell those who are invited, see, I have prepared my dinner, my ox and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast. But they paid him no attention and went off one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his servants, treated them shamefully, and killed them. The king was angry, and he sent his troops and destroyed those murderers and burnt their city. Then he said to his servants, "The wedding feast is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go, therefore, to the main roads and invite to the wedding feast as many as you can find." And those servants went out into the roads and gathered all whom they found, both bad and good. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. Let me just stop right there for a second in the parable and just say the first thing that I want to draw to your attention about the chosen in this parable that Jesus has shared is there is one call, yet there are always two crowds. When identifying the chosen, there's just one call, but there's always multiple crowds. Verse number 9 in the text says, "Go therefore to the main roads and invite to the wedding feast as many as you can find." Last week we talked about there is a need to distinguish the difference between the gifted and the called. The world looks and pans after the gifted, but God uses the called. Can I say that one more time?
Yes.
The world fiends after, they pursue, and they throw all kinds of things at people who are gifted, but it's so critically important for the church to hear and know that you can be as gifted as you want to be. Your gift means nothing if you ain't been called.
Come on.
So calling gives way to more gifting. You can be gifted without being called, but if you mind your business around your gift, your gift around your call, your gift will make room for you. Let me say that one more time. You can be gifted without being called, but if you mind your business around your call, your gift will make room for you. And one of the responsibilities that we have is to keep the unity, to stay connected to those who God has called to be in our life.
Right. Wow. Amen.
Don't build bridges between gifts. Maintain the unity around who God called you to be in relationship with. There's one body and one spirit, just as you were called to one hope that belongs to your call. Ephesians chapter number 4, verse number 4. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to one hope that belongs to your call. And what I'm basically trying to say is what I've been saying to you for the last couple of weeks. Mind your business. Mind your business. Unity is the key that unlocks our call by providing perspective that our gifts are in desperate need of. Minding your business is not about staying or keeping to yourself. It's just the opposite.
Okay.
It's about engaging into and with those things and people that the Lord has placed into your life until you achieve peace, which is the evidence of a kingdom prophet. Oh, that verse, I said so much in that. I feel like I need to say one more again. Can I read it to you as the Lord had me write it? Unity is the key that unlocks your call by providing perspective that your gift needs. So you can have a gift, but if your gift ain't got perspective, then all you is gifting. So what it takes in order for your gift to be used properly by God is unity. That's how you gain perspective. It's our job to mind our business, not by staying to ourselves, because that's something that a lot of us tend to do. When you're unsure about how or if you feel as though your gift is threatened, what we do is we cocoon ourselves. We hide ourselves out, and it's just the opposite of that. You don't need no alone time. Sit there. I'm coming for you. You know how crazy you are. I wish I had a couple of people in here that are willing to admit. you don't like you. So you mean to tell me that when God is ready to utilize your gifts, He's going to let you take counsel with yourself?
No,
just the opposite. He's going to force you to be around people who He's called into your life so that your crazy self can have perspective on what God has put into your life.
Yes, sir. Please,
Lord.
It is the business of the gifted to stay connected with the called so that you have perspective until you gain peace out of your gift, because it's the peace that you're able to gain by maintaining the unity that proves there's a kingdom prophet and not just a personal one. There's a difference between a kingdom prophet and a personal prophet. God is more concerned about the profit that others gain from your gift, not just you. Secondly, what we can deduce about the chosen is not just simply that there's one call and that there are multiple two crowds. The second thing we can deduce about the chosen is everyone who comes is first called. Everybody who comes was called. Verse 10, chapter 22, Matthew's gospel, it says those, and those servants went out into the roads and gathered all whom they found, both bad and good. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. Can I say something to you that the comfortable in God might miss? No one comes to God who was not invited by God. Let me just pause there parenthetically before I finish my statement. Just think about that for a moment. Think about all of the people who you have invited that have never come. The only reason why you and I are here is because God invited us. He might have used somebody as a tool or a vessel, but if it wasn't for God doing something in us, we would have ignored them like we always had.
Amen.
Nobody comes to God who God did not first call. Therefore, everyone is to be treated as His guest. How we treat others who gather where God has called us exposes to what capacity our gift is called by God. How we treat others who gather where God has called us exposes to what capacity our gift is called by God. Okay. There's a whole bunch of people who are gifted in the place of God, but their gift ain't from God. The thing that they are using in order to make a name for themselves ain't what God gave them in order to make a name for Him. And this is the reason why our connections are call-based, not gift-based. Okay, let's meddle for a minute. How many of us, and don't say nothing so that don't nobody know I'm talking about you. But how many of us have perfected things in our lives that God can't use? That when you go to take that thing that you's known for and you bring it to the sanctuary. Can't nobody do nothing with that in here? Now you might be incredibly proficient at it, and you might get some people who applaud you for it, but in the house of God, God has absolutely, positively, no... In other words, it gonna die when your body dies. If that is what you're proficient at, your gift has no value in the kingdom, which is why our connections are call-based, not gift-based. How we treat others who gather where God has called us exposes to what capacity our gift is called by God. I feel like I'm meddling a little more. The crazy thing about this, and Bruce, I hope I don't get ahead of myself, but the crazy thing about this is that when you're starting your journey, you don't know the difference between gifts you've perfected and gifts God gave.
Right. Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen.
You're just excited that you have something you're proficient at. Which is why the church is a place that's run by God and not man.
Come on. Yeah.
Because God knows the difference and he will gently transition us from worldly gifts to godly gifts.
Yes.
The problem is, in between God's transformation of us in our worldly gifts to our godly gifts, in the middle are Negroes.
Right.
It's church people.
Right.
I'm ahead of myself, Dana. Who never like to give you the grace to transform. Who expect you to come in fully ready, not realizing that you's just as ignorant about which gift belongs where. So how you treat people when they come into God's house exposes to what degree God can use you. And just because you're called don't mean you chose. Let me ask you a question.
Glory God.
Are you judgmental? Let me answer the question so you don't have to sit there and lie. Yes, you're judgmental. We all are. Because we are all tied to original sin.
Right.
We tend to pay no attention, however, when our judgment turns to self-righteous.
Come on.
So let me just kind of set the stage again because I've got a little bit more work to do. The question was, is you judgmental? The answer is yes. Because the reality is we all are. The challenge is not so much that you're judgmental or that I'm judgmental. The challenge is we're nose deaf to when we become self-righteous. So here's what God said through Paul in order to help us filter our foolishness lest we fracture what God has constructed. Would you like to be able to know the difference when you trip the light fantastic and you end up on the wrong side of God with your judgmental self?
Yes.
Here's what it says. Romans chapter number 2, verses 1 through 5 says this. Therefore, you have no excuse, O man, every one of you who judges. For in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself. Because you, the judge, practice the very same thing. We know that the judgment of God rightly falls on those who practice such things. Do you suppose, O man, you who judge those who practice such things and yet do them yourself, that you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you presume on the richness of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? But because of your hard and impotent heart, you are storing up for yourselves on the day of wrath when God's righteous judgment will be revealed.
Wow.
And I told you I got ahead of myself a moment ago, because what God does is he brings people from all walks of life to walk into the house where God is.
Yeah. Yes.
And he expects those who have a call and a gifting to treat them well, because he's transforming them just like he's transforming him. But ain't it just like church folk? To sit in judgment of others instead of judging themselves. The problem that that presents is God doesn't always snatch you up at the point of your judgment.
Right.
The text said, he's waiting. He's storing it up. Which is why you better keep a good calculation of your own actions, lest you fall yourself. When we judge people based on what we know about them, we're not leveling accusations at them, but at God for his invitation to them. What am I trying to say here in my second point? Mind your business. Because like we said on Thursday night at Bible study, there are some lessons that are too expensive to unlearn.
Amen. Yes.
The process of sanctification can only occur after justification has been understood. And to the degree that we discover how wretched we are, which is revealed in and by comparison, we don't understand how much God loves us.
Yeah.
Okay, I said hold out right there. Can I say it one more time?
Yeah.
Sanctification, which is the process of transformation, it is the process of starting in one place and ending up at another, only happens after justification. Justification is when you receive what you don't deserve, as if you hadn't done what qualified you not to deserve it.
Okay.
But you can only be transformed after you receive a pardon. You can't be transformed while you're still guilty. Because guilt will keep reminding you that you don't deserve it. So what Jesus does is he justifies us and then he sanctifies us. He forgives us and then he transforms us. Are you still with me? Now here's the thing. He forgives us and then he takes us on this journey of transformation. But the reason why the journey of transformation, the sanctification, is always going on until you see him is because there are some things that you don't understand how deeply you've been forgiven for until you're able to get around some other folks who were forgiven. Until you get into a place where you're able to compare how wretched you really are. See, if your ratchetness is exposed before your forgiveness, you don't care how ratchet you are. When you were in sin and you were hanging around with whoever you were hanging around, did you care how deep it got?
No.
The only time it could matter was when you were compared with some other folks, like the experiences were completely different. Wait. You mean you never dropped it like it was hot? I thought everybody dropped it like it's hot. What you mean you don't? You ain't never smoked weed. I thought everybody did. What you mean every night? You were with some, I mean, it wasn't a revolving door at your house like it wasn't mine? You mean you saved yourself for marriage?
Come on.
See, it's only in and through comparison after you've been forgiven that you're able to understand the depth the width, the breadth of how much God has forgiven of you. He doesn't reveal that so that you feel some kind of way about you. He reveals it so that you can feel some kind of way about him. It's so that we might understand how much God loves us, which gives way to repentance. Because when you get a good glimpse and smell of you, your sin, all you want to do is, God, I'm sorry. That's what Paul is saying in Romans chapter number 2. His kindness, his forbearance brings about repentance. Which is why judgment ain't got no space. Which is why godly kindness is a gift of the Spirit. It's a fruit of the Spirit. But it all begins with an invitation. And everyone who comes is called. Can I say that one more time? And I'm going to move to my third point. Everyone who comes is called. And those servants went out into the roads and gathered all who they found, both bad and good. I love Jesus. Amen. I don't love y'all's religious Jesus. I love Jesus. Because just when the religious folks were missing it, he tells this parable how the religious folks were a part of that first group and they were too busy. He invited them, but they had something on their plate. They had to go back to their farms and to their businesses. And then they were self-righteous to the degree that when he called them and found them doing something they weren't supposed to be doing, instead of going, they killed the servants. Oh, well, now I'm just going to discredit. Oh, that ain't God. That church ain't God. What they need me here. Why you got to be here? No problem. Stay where you is. Because God's about to burn the whole thing down. Oh, I can't come. I got to work. That's all right. I'm burning the whole thing down. Oh, I prayed for this person, and now we're going to brunch. No problem. God's going to burn the whole thing down.
Come on now.
What I love is that God is complete in himself. He could have just given out one invitation. And not been any less God. But his love for us is so great that he said, if the religious right don't want me, go out into the street. Lord, I wish I had some real misfits in the building. Go out into the street. And don't look at who they are. Know what they're doing when you find them. And just so that we're clear, and we don't think that he's talking about some saints that were on a stroll. Catch up. He said the bad and the good, and bring them. We're on my bad boys. Look at all my bad girls, man. Get at me, bad girl. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. Here's the last thing that I want to bring to your attention about the Chosen. Are y'all all right?
Amen.
They're transformed. Mm-hmm. I'm in verse number 11, chapter 22, Matthew's gospel. It says this: but when the king came in to look at the guests, he saw there was a man who had no wedding garment. And he said to him, friend, how did you get in here without wedding garments? And he was speechless. The king said to the attendant, bind him hand and foot and cast him into outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen. Can I just stop for a second and just ask a question? Does that change the way you see that text now?
Yes.
That statement? The person who gets kicked out is the one who does not have on wedding garments, who took the invitation but had no transformation. Who was invited but has chosen not to participate, just spectate. God has brought them into a new season, into a new thing, but they are determined to keep doing the old things.
Yeah.
They have resolved that who they have been, which has made them who they are, is of greater importance than who God is creating them to be. And though they have been called, they have chosen not to change.
Amen.
The chosen embrace transformation so much so that the mere fact that they are here is the evidence that God has changed something in their life.
Yes.
But the guests of God have going for them that the comfortable in God have lost sight of is the guests realize that God did not have to invite them.
Jesus, come on. Come on.
It's a slight edge. It's a small little thing. But the guests of God realize that the folks who've been here since the foundational brick was laid is that the guests realize God didn't have to invite them.
Amen.
God could have kept them doing what they were doing when he found them.
Amen.
God could have kept them at Bedside Baptist. God could have allowed them to continue to believe that good works can replace an authentic connection with God.
Amen.
The chosen understand transformation from an intimate perspective.
Right.
Paul said in 2 Corinthians 4, 16 and 18, so we do not lose heart, though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light and momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison, as we look not to the things that are seen. In other words, you can't tell what God is doing in me if the only thing you know about me is what you see in me. We look not to the things that are seen, but the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal.
Amen.
Transformation is not a one-time occurrence. The chosen are constantly being transformed. Who you saw me as last week, I can be somebody completely different this
Amen.
Week.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Who I knew myself to be in the middle of the week is somebody that I can be completely different on next week. How can you get comfortable in an eternally transformative God? How can you settle on business as usual or being who you've always been when God is so vast?
Amen. Yes, sir.
How could you hold him in a box when there's not a box that can hold him? Why could you reserve yourself to being this way when God is so many different ways? Why would you settle for this when he has that and that and that and that? Whenever you get comfortable in God, you are about to lose. So what am I trying to tell you? Mind! You ain't got time to focus on anything other than your own transformation. Because if you're transforming the way that God wants you to transform, then your gifts will make room for you. If you're so concerned about what somebody else's gifts is doing, then you're not transforming the way he has made available for you.
Yes.
Every new day, we get old mercies. Oh, that's not what it says. God has never repeated a mercy. In the same way that a cloud you see today, 5 minutes from now, It won't be the same cloud.
Amen.
If God can take water vapor,
Jesus, come on now,
and transform it from one thing to another,
Lord, to another.
Do you mean to tell me you, who was created in the image of the Omega Bay, would actually settle for the same old thing? Brand new mercies are available every day. So if you ain't new, guess whose fault it is? Notice that I gotta close this out. Notice the question on the table by the king was not, who are you?
Right.
Nor was it, how did you get in here? The question is, how did you get in here without wedding garments?
Now,
he didn't ask you where you came from.
Jesus.
He didn't even ask you what name you made for yourself. He didn't ask you how they know you. His question was, how did you get in here without, how did you get in here without changing? Can I ask you a question as we prepare to close?
Lord.
What did you have to change in order to come in here today? What happened since the last time you was in here that is forcing you to be different than the last time you were in here? See, we're so busy trying to keep things the way they've always been, not realizing that if you don't change, you're going to look out of place. The difference between the called and the chosen rests in a willingness to change. Ephesians 4:7 says this, but grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. Many are called, few are chosen. Who God chooses to use has nothing to do with who they were or even who they are. But if they choose to receive His grace, they are then gifted. The difference between the called and the few is, but grace was given.
Amen.
Everyone has a calling. Only few choose to receive to walk in it. Everyone has a calling, but few receive the grace in order to walk in their calling. Your call, my call, means nothing if we fail to remember it's only by His grace. Can I say that one more time as we shut this thing down? Your call, my call, means absolutely positively nothing if we fail to remember to walk in the grace that He gave us when He gave us the call. A graceless Christian is not a Christian. Any gift you got that is not through grace means it did not come from Him. It's only His grace that I'm not caught up. It's only by His grace that I'm not tied up, tangled up, caught up in the things that the first group, the first crowd got caught up in. Making a name for myself, taking care of my family, doing the things that seem right to me. Those things could have been a distraction to me as it is to so many. It's only by His grace that I was able to hear His call and not get caught up and distracted by all of the cares of this world. It's only by grace and I found myself captured by him.
Right.
Because where I was when I heard him call me, it wasn't in the solitude of a sanctuary.
Come on.
Come on.
But it was doing something scandalous in the streets.
Mm-hmm.
I wish I had a little bit of help. It wasn't at no altar where I first heard the call. Remember, in order to be in here, you gotta first be invited. So that's not where I first heard it. It was when I had put myself in a situation that had far extended my ability to maintain it.
Yes. Mercy.
And his grace came and captured me because I had created a debt I couldn't pay. I wish I had somebody who was being so deep that we run for his grace to come and stretch you. It was only his grace that could change me. Because left to my own devices, even to today, what you see in me is not exactly what should be. It's gotta be his grace on my life. Because left to my own devices, up until this very moment, what you see ain't what it should be. It's his grace covering me.
Yes.
It's his grace changing me. Because the good that I would do, I don't do. And the evil I shouldn't do, guess what, Pimp? I'm still doing. But it was his grace that came in and said, I got you. I'm not getting what I deserve. And it's because his grace is changing me. His grace. His grace has come and made us.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Worthy.
Hallelujah.
Many are called.
Many.
The called are a dime a dozen.
Yes. Jesus.
Proper understanding of the text is everybody's called. Few are chosen. And the choosing from the called has nothing to do with because they are special.
Yeah.
It's because he's special. And when he becomes special to you, you choose him. And it's your choosing of him because he's so special to you that separates you from everybody else that's called.
Lord.
If it wasn't for his grace.
Come on, for his grace.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
Where would I be?
Thank you, Lord.
My gift would be nothing.
Thank you, God.
If it wasn't for his grace. So since the only reason why you see anything of any merit in me is because he graced me to have it. The only way anyone can benefit from any gift that I've been called to give is when I operate by
grace.
Thank you, Jesus.
That's the chosen. That's the chosen. That's the chosen.
Thank you, Lord.
It's grace. If it wasn't for his grace.
Lord.
If it wasn't for his grace.
Come on,
Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
Your pedigree, your resume, your goodness on your best day is as filthy rags. It's his grace. It's the grace of God on your life. It's the grace of God that's kept your life. It's the grace of God that's sustaining your life.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
Praise
God.
Everybody in here has a call.
Yes, Lord.
When you answer the call, God is going to reveal your gift. But the difference between hearing the call and operating in your gift is grace.
Amen.
I pray that the Lord gives us grace to not only answer his call on our life, but to be transformed so that the gifts from our life the ability to give Him glory. That's our business. So may we get our minds right about it.
Yes.
He's my mind regulator.
Amen.
By grace.
By grace.
Because if it wasn't for His grace,
come on, Jesus,
where would I be?
Yes.
Many are called. You are chosen. With heads bowed and eyes shut. Father, in the name of Jesus, we just humbly bow before your throne of grace, asking first that you forgive us. Forgive us for focusing in on any and everything other than the grace that was extended to us to have even heard you call us, to receive an invitation from you. Because you could have left us where you found us.
Yes.
But it was your grace that came and got us. And now, God, that we're here, let us not lose sight of the fact that it will be your grace that will keep us. It'll be your grace that will expose what you want to do through us. And it'll be your grace that will do the thing that we apply ourselves to. For that we thank you. For that we praise you. For that we glorify your holy name. Wash us afresh with grace, God, from the crowns of our heads to the soles of our feet. Do a new work in our minds and in our hearts by grace. Give us eyes that see through grace. Ears that hear through grace, minds that perceive through grace, hearts that feel through grace, so that your grace, your grace, does what you sent it to do. Be one of the wonder twins. For John 1 says that Jesus came, the Word came full of grace and truth. It is the grace that you extend that affords us to comprehend the truth. That without grace, all other truths become distorted. What we understand about what we know and perceive outside of grace is a distortion. So God, we just thank you that when your word becomes flesh, when your word becomes true to us, and we receive it in the grace in which it was sent, the truth then can transform us. So God, right now we thank you for Jesus, who walked and talked the embodiment of grace and truth. And now we receive him fully so that we might be the graceful gifts to the world that you saved us to be. May you receive the glory out of us. May you receive the glory out of us. May you receive the glory out of us. For this is our prayer. In Jesus' name, and all of God's children said,
amen.
Can you put your hands together and bless it?